Welcome to Christ United Methodist Church. My name is Chris Dowd. I'm the senior pastor. And whether you're worshiping with us in person or online, we are delighted to be worshiping together during this Advent and Christmas season. It's such a wonderful time of the year and a wonderfully full time of the year. We have special worship services, special programs, of course, a full schedule of worship on Christmas Eve. If you have questions about any of that, you can go to cumc.com/connect, and that's one spot where you'll find the answers that you need. Before we get started in worship today, please do let us know that you're here. If you're worshiping with us online, there's a place for you to check in on the website, or you can comment in the comment section on Facebook. If you're in person, on the back of your bulletin, there's a QR code that you can scan and check in that way, or you can take a check-in card from the pew in front of you, fill that out manually, and drop it in the offering plate when the plate comes by. Again, it is so good to be worshiping together during this special season.
Hi, I'm Meredith McBride, Director of Children's Ministries. We are so glad to have your whole family here with us for worship this Advent season. Children are a very important part of all of our worship services at Christ United. We love seeing them serve as acolytes and in the choir. Stop by and grab an activity bag or a book on your way in. At 11 o'clock service, be sure to come on down front for children's time. See you soon, friends.
Hi, I'm Reagan Gilliland, Pastor of Adult Discipleship. Thanks again for joining us this joyous season. It's almost time for our service to begin. I hope you'll take a moment after the service has ended to stop by our Get Connected area in the atrium to check out about upcoming events, sign up for a class, learn about membership, or chat with a volunteer about how you can get plugged in here. You can stay in the loop on all the details by subscribing to our weekly newsletter or learn more about upcoming events at cumc.com/connect. Have a wonderful Sunday. Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas!
Thank you.
Christmas. Please be seated, everybody. Welcome. It's great to see you all on this Christmas Eve. I was honestly worried as the game got closer and closer to a potential overtime that we would have to delay the start, but I won't ruin it for you. I'm sure you've got phones and you know that the little Christmas magic that we needed worked. But I won't ruin it for you. A couple of things to call to your attention before we get started today, and the first is that tomorrow morning we are going to have a worship service, but it is only one combined worship service here in the sanctuary at 10 a.m. The same will be true for a week for tomorrow on New Year's Day, so just make note on your calendar for that if you're planning on being here in worship tomorrow or a week from tomorrow. And then we have so much wonderful ways to celebrate Christmas Eve here coming up. I just want to make one announcement about what's going on in January. This coming year is our 50th anniversary as a congregation, and we have lots of special stuff planned throughout the year that begins in the middle of January through the end of January with a sermon series called Awakening. But the sermon series, I'm sure that'll be great. I'm excited. I'm looking forward to it. But it's because of the work of the next slide, a woman named Lisa Miller, who is a researcher, a professor. She's done pioneering work in the connection between spirituality and mental health. And of course, mental health is something that's on all of our minds, coming out of the pandemic especially, and she's done really wonderful work in that, and she's going to be here on campus doing a workshop at the end of January. So we'll have 3 weeks of a sermon series based on a book of hers, and then we'll get to hear from her directly if you would like to. I'm excited about that. It is, again, so good to be together on Christmas Eve. Let's continue to worship.
During the season of Advent, we have lit the candles of hope, love, joy, and peace. Today we light the Christ candle, the center of them all. and remember that Jesus was sent to bring hope, love, joy, and peace to the world. Glory to God. Amen.
Exactly. All right, we'll be reading from the Gospel of Luke tonight. I'm going to read verses 1 to 7 first, and we'll come back and read a little bit more later. Listen, friends, for the word of God as it is proclaimed by God's servant, the evangelist Luke. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the end. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There are many, many reasons why people love this time of year so much. I'm guessing that you have your own list of favorite things about Christmas. I certainly do. We are in the middle of one of them right now. Christmas Eve worship is truly a highlight of the year for me. And it seems to me that how we feel about the Christmas season is very closely linked to our memories of this season. Now, hopefully, those memories on balance are good. If not, I hope that you're making some new good memories to replace the old difficult ones, because our memories about Christmas, maybe more than any other time of the year, tend to shape how we feel about this season and how we experience it. You know what I mean? Like, okay, so let me give you an example. If you think about your favorite Christmas gifts that you've received as a child, the ones that really stand out in your memory. Now, hopefully, every Christmas held some wonderful surprise under the tree, but there are probably a few that immediately come to mind. Now, the earliest one for me was one Christmas morning. This was before my little brother was born. There was an incredible Lionel train set under the tree when I woke up that morning. It had a train station, and it had a coal station with actual fake coal that you dumped into the railway cars. It had long tracks so that you could go really fast without derailing. I probably played with that train until I was a teenager. I loved that train. A few years later, one magical Christmas morning, okay, there's some Gen X in here, I love it. My little brother and I got an Atari 2600. Now, for all of you youngins out there, this was peak technology in the early 80s. And it was absolutely what every kid wanted to find under the Christmas tree. I have no idea how many hours my little brother and I played Asteroids and Space Invaders and Missile Command. The sound effects for Pac-Man, waka, 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 oh. That was the soundtrack of my childhood. And then, when I was a teenager, oh man, I got a pair of these beauties. If I still had them, I'd wear them tonight. Now, I've always been a Mavs fan, always. Never was a Bulls fan, but every kid playing high school basketball in the mid-1980s wanted a pair of Air Jordans, and I was lucky enough to get one. Didn't really help my game all that much, as I recall, but I sure felt like a big deal when I was wearing them. Now, maybe some of your fondest memories of this time of year are about particular gifts, or maybe they're about particular people with whom you spent the holidays, or about particular places that you used to go. Whatever your most cherished memories of Christmas may be, chances are those memories have shaped how you feel about this blessed day and may even come rushing back to you at some point during each season. Now, I'm also guessing that there are particular songs, both secular and sacred, that are deeply ingrained in your memory, songs that bring out those fond emotions when you hear them, because I don't think that there's another time of year when music is so closely tied to our experience of the season. For example, there's a secular, a non-religious song whose opening notes immediately take me to Christmas. And I'm the type of person that every once in a while I'll put on the Christmas playlist just randomly in the middle of the year. And when I hear this song, it immediately takes me to Christmas. The title of this song has almost become the way we define this season. So it was recorded and released by Andy Williams in 1963. Always makes me smile. And I guess I'm gonna bet you can guess it from the opening notes. Now, I did this with my 16-year-old. He got it immediately. Let's see how you do. Ben bailing me out. Great. It is the most wonderful time of the year. Yes, every time I hear that song, I think of like this moment right now. And the lyrics of the carols that we sing on Christmas Eve are so familiar. They're so much a part of this night. I mean, there are things that we just have to hear and sing. Oh, come, all you faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. We're going to hear that here shortly. And of course, silent night, holy night. We'll close with that. But the truth is, all of the trappings of this season, all those things about which we have such fond memories, I'm talking about the traditions and the decorations and the gift giving and the parties, even the music, all of that is really just extra. All of that other stuff just embellishes the true point of tonight, which is the story that we've all come to hear. That's the point. It is perhaps the most familiar story in the history of the world. It's the story that means everything to those who have faith. It's the story that could mean everything to those who don't have faith yet. No matter where you are in your journey of faith, chances are you know some of the details. Chances are you know about Joseph and Mary and the trip to Bethlehem. Chances are you know about the inn that had no room and about the manger and about the animals and about the shepherds. Chances are you know about the Magi. They're over there on the creche, even though that's a different gospel and that happened at a later time. We'll talk about that on Epiphany. And chances are that you have some deeply held memories about this season that have shaped your experience of it. And I hope those memories are good, but even if they're not, the punchline of the story is the best news ever. So let's get to that now. This is Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 20. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. It probably goes without saying that there is no other day, no other holiday, no other time of year that the world makes such a fuss about as this one. And that, of course, includes the almost one-third of the world's population who identify as Christian. That's almost 2.5 billion people in all. I hope those 2.5 billion people are in church somewhere today. But it also includes people who celebrate Christmas without claiming faith in Jesus, which, if you ask me, is just fine as a starting point. Because the first people to hear the good news of Christ's birth, the shepherds living in the field watching over their flock by night, did not at that point claim faith in Christ. And yet the angel of the Lord was very clear, "I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior." That same good news of great joy is for everyone today, everyone here, everyone in person, everyone online, wherever you are in your journey of faith. And we're all over the map as people gathered here today. If you're a lifelong Christian who's here every Sunday and for whom church is the most natural thing in the world, if you're struggling with your faith for whatever reason, if you've left church for a while and are kicking the tires to see if you want to come back, if you haven't begun your journey of faith yet, wherever you are in your journey of faith, tonight we celebrate the good news of great joy for all the people. And the incredible thing to me is that all that is asked of us, all that God desires, is for us to say yes to the offer, for us to open our hearts to God, to be willing to take that first step in faith. Because that first step is a first step towards transformation. It's the first step towards spiritual growth and the assurance of God's grace. It's the first step toward a new way of living that gives our lives the meaning and the purpose that otherwise elude us. That's the point of this night of all nights. And so for me, there is no amount of pageantry too extravagant to wrap around this invitation from God, knowingly or unknowingly, the many, many wonders of this season, knowingly or unknowingly, the many, many reasons people love this time of year so much. All of it, all of that extra stuff just enhances what God is announcing to all of us on this night. And I hope that every one of us is able to hear. And I mean hear, deep in our souls, what the angel of the Lord said to the shepherd and says to us all, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. Some of my earliest memories of watching TV are of this show. Mork and Mindy. Anybody else here watch? Oh, yeah. Yes. Oh, man. This was must-see TV in our house way before that term was coined, before must-see TV was a thing. And the show made me a fan of Robin Williams. And over the years, I've seen just about every film that Robin Williams has made. I've got fond memories, actually, of watching his career evolve as he grew from this kind of zany alien to much more serious roles. Good Morning Vietnam, The Fisher King, which is incredible. What Dreams May Come, very underrated. Good Will Hunting. But my favorite of his movies is 1989's Dead Poets Society. It came out when I was in college. It's still one of my top five movies, favorite movies of all time. And in fact, all the way up until the day that I heard my call to ordained ministry, I would have told you that my dream job was to teach high school English, just like Williams' character in this movie. He plays a man named John Keating, who's an unconventional teacher who shakes up the stodgy private school in New England where he works. And he encourages his students to become more than they thought they could. And my favorite scene in this movie, which is one of my favorite movies of all time, is a moment of transformation that he inspires in one of his students. So he's assigned each of them to write an original poem to present to the class, and there's one of the kids in the class who just does not think he's up to the task. And I know this is not a Christmas movie, but this scene has a message, I think, that's relevant for us tonight. So let's check it out.
Now, who's next?
Mr. Anderson, so you're sitting there in agony. Come on, Todd, step up. Let's put you out of your misery.
I didn't do it. I didn't write a poem.
Mr. Anderson thinks that everything inside of him is worthless and embarrassing. Isn't that right, Todd? And that's your worst fear. Well, I think you're wrong. I think you have something inside of you that is worth a great deal. I sound my barbaric yelp. The rooftops of the world. W.W. Uncle Walt again. Now, for those of you who don't know, a yelp is a loud cry or yell. Now, Todd, I would like you to give us a demonstration of a barbaric yelp. Come on, you can't yelp sitting down. Let's go. Come on, up. Gotta get in yelping stance.
A yelp.
No, not just a yelp. A barbaric yelp.
Yelp.
Come on, louder.
Yelp.
Oh, that's a mouse. Come on, louder.
Yelp.
Oh, good God, boy, yell like a man.
There it is.
You see, you have a barbarian in you after all. Now, you don't get away that easy. Picture of Uncle Walt up there. What does he remind you of? Don't think. Answer. Go on.
A madman.
What kind of madman? Don't think about it. Just answer again.
A crazy madman.
Oh, you can do better than that. Free up your mind. Use your imagination. Say the first thing that pops into your head, even if it's total gibberish.
Go on, go on. A sweaty tooth madman.
Good God, boy. There's a poet in you after all.
There. Close your eyes.
Close your eyes.
Close them. Now, describe what you see.
I close my eyes.
Yes?
And this image floats beside me.
The sweaty tooth madman.
The sweaty tooth madman. With a stare that pounds my brain.
Oh, that's excellent. Now give him action. Make him do something.
His hands reach out and choke me.
That's good. Wonderful, wonderful.
And all the time he's mumbling.
What's he mumbling?
Mumbling truth.
Yeah, yeah.
Truth like a blanket that always leaves your feet cold.
Forget them, forget them. Stay with the blanket. Tell me about that blanket.
You push it, stretch it. It'll never be enough. You kick at it, beat it. It'll never cover any of us. From the moment we enter crying to the moment we leave dying, it'll just cover your face as you wail and cry. And scream.
Yeah. Don't you forget this.
I love that last line so much. Having inspired this shy, self-conscious boy to find his voice, having shown him a glimpse of what's inside him, having seen him take that first step that will surely lead to bigger things, Mr. Keating makes this plea. It's not a command, it's a plea. He says, don't you forget this. Don't forget the way you feel right now. And that's how I feel about the way many of us feel on this most blessed of nights. Maybe tonight is the night that some of us feel closest to God. That was true for me at times of my life, or at least most open to the invitation of God. I mean, how can you not be open to the invitation of God, right, in this beautiful place with this amazing music on the eve of our most beloved day of the year? And I am convinced that in the midst of a season that is so often defined by our memories, all of us need to take the memory of this night with us when we leave. The memory of this night needs to go with us when we walk out those doors, because between this Christmas and next, there will be great highs and terrible lows in every one of our lives. Someone you love may be born in the coming year, while someone you love may go on to their eternal reward. Some relationships in your life will bring you joy, while some may get rocky and others may come to an end. Some things in life will go exactly the way you want them to, while others will feel like a great defeat or even a great tragedy. In the world, in the daily news, there will be these poignant moments of great beauty and great grace, moments that remind us of our common humanity and our shared destiny, and there will surely be examples of suffering that will shake our faith in humanity and make us despair at the human condition. Between this Christmas and next, so much will happen. So much will happen that every single one of us, in our joy and in our grief, in our triumphs and in our disasters, in our laughter and in our tears, between this Christmas and next, every single one of us will need the promise and the grace of God that we're being offered here tonight. In the words of the angel, I am bringing you. Good news, the best news of great joy. For all the people, to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. In the words of Mr. Keating, don't you forget this. Amen.
Thank you.
Methodist. And again, we want to say thank you so much for joining us in worship, whether you're here in person or joining us online. So here at Christ United Methodist, it has been our longstanding tradition that our offering on Christmas Eve goes to our mission, serving others. Because we believe strongly as disciples of Christ, we are called to give and serve in all the ways in which we can. And so right now, we even have some members serving at Plano Overnight Warming Station for our friends and people in our community that are dealing and suffering from homelessness. So whether it is through food or shelter or clothing or tutoring and schools or construction or helping families get out of the cycle of poverty through our Project Hope program, we believe strongly here at Christ United Methodist that we should give in all the ways we can. And so thank you tonight that that you may be led to give, and knowing that those gifts will go to impact so many lives outside of these walls, into our community, and into our world. So let us go to God together in giving. is such a joy and a privilege to pray together as a family. And so I invite you to pray. Let's go to God in prayer together. Gracious and loving God, just like the shepherds that your angels appeared to and revealed your glory on that night long ago, we have also witnessed your saving grace in the Christ child. So we give you thanks and praise for your love and for your gift of Jesus, who came for all the world and showed us how to live as we follow him and love and care for others. Oh God, as we give our thanks and praise to you on the night of your son's birth, help us to also share your gift of love with those who are struggling at this time. Allow us to be mindful of those who are hurting, who are lonely, and who face uncertainty in their lives. Give us wisdom and courage to step out of our daily routines and to reach out to those who need to know that someone cares. And help us to know that as we walk with them in their struggles, so your Holy Spirit also walks with them and will bring them to a place of peace and rest. May the love of the Christ child shine through us to brighten a world in need of your grace. May we continue to be witnesses of this grace to our families, our friends, and even the strangers we encounter. Help us to remember we are all your beloved children, no matter who we are, where we come from, or what we have done. We ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught all of us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Now we come to what I know for many of us is the holiest moment of the year in worship. A couple of notes by way of instruction. So I'm going to light my candle off of the Christ candle, and then Reagan is going to light her candle for mine, and we'll demonstrate how to do that. The ushers will assist the balcony by lighting various folks in the balcony who will then pass the light down. We have ushers on the floor who will go to the back few and work their way front towards the front as Reagan and I work towards the back. And we ask that as the light passes from the center, you would go ahead and pass it across the aisles as well. The choir has prepared a special arrangement of Silent Night. We'll have plenty of time. There's no rush. You are invited to remain seated at first while the choir sings an opening verse, I believe, and then Ben will signal us when to sing as a congregation. So when you're lighting the candle that's lit should be like this, like straight, and then the unlit candle lights off of it so we don't, drip wax on each other. We don't want to do that.
Frozen in the snow, I rose and see me. shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen, and Merry Christmas.